Generation Alpha describes the current generation of children born since 2010. With over 2.8 million births worldwide every week, they are projected to become the largest generation in history, surpassing 2 billion by 2025. Generation Alpha already holds considerable brand influence and purchasing power. They shape the social media landscape, influence popular culture, and drive consumer trends. So, joining me today to discuss our latest research on this significant generation is social researcher and principal at McCrindle, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to another season of the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Great to be talking Gen Alpha with you.
It's crazy that we're commencing season 9 of this podcast. So really delighted to be beginning this next season with discussing some of the research that we have gathered from our Generations Defined report and research about Generation Alpha. Now, I'm sure that people who are well-versed in the McCrindle sphere know that you coined the term, Mark, but I always love to tell the story on your behalf. I think it's just such a, I say it's a random claim to fame. It's a pretty cool kind of story. So I wondered, Mark, if there are any new listeners out there or even faithful listeners or people in our audience who might not actually be aware of the generation and how you came to name them, if you could just reiterate that story for us.
Sure. Well, it was over a decade ago. It was, in fact, around 2008 when I was putting together a book called The ABC of XYZ, and all about understanding the global generations. And the focus was on the Gen X, Gen Y, Gen Z. It became pretty evident in doing that research that Generation Z was about to be complete as a generation and what's coming next. So we, as researchers, ran a survey. We said to respondents, what do you think the next generation after Z should be? We've got to the end of the alphabet now. And a lot of responses came back that were around technology, the dot-com kids or the online generation, the iGen, all this sort of stuff. Probably the most common answer was Generation A. If we got through XYZ, it must be A. And I particularly didn't want that and didn't think that would be a good option because we're not going back to the start. It's not just a circular thing. It's the start of a whole new reality. And so I put all that research to the side and said, all right, let's go with Generation Alpha. Let's use that scientific nomenclature. Let's go with the Greek letters. Let's move from the Latin alphabet to the Greek one. And the alphabet thing works. It makes it easy. X, Y, Z, you know what's coming next. Let's do the same, but start on a new platform. So Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta, et cetera. And so that's what I put forward and that's what has stuck now, which I'm glad to see because, as you know, Ash, we wrote the book of that name together. It's really helpful when there is a name that not only has global resonance, which never quite worked with millennials. You know, some people say millennials, Gen Y. We want a name that everyone can recognize because it's a global generation and a name that isn't laden with a particular snapshot in time, like, the AI generation. Well, that's not going to last very long because AI is a big deal now, but it'll just be part of who we are in 10 years. Let's choose a label that is a systemized label. So then we've got Beta coming next and a label that they can create their own meaning from. And all of that is what's behind Generation Alpha. And so here we have the label for the new generation.
Yeah, it's a really cool story and amazing that you could write that kind of into existence and be credited with giving them that label and put out a lot of research about them. And like you mentioned, we've done the book and we write a lot of articles and reports about them and love to use them as a bit of a lens through which to look at the future and how they're going to live and work. And we explored a lot of that in the different chapters of the Generation Alpha book. So fascinating generation, growing up in fascinating times. It's great to hear as well, just reiterate that story because sometimes I get asked, Alpha's a great name for them. Is it because they're going to be, dominant and they're just going to be so confident? And I'm like, well, that's not really why we chose that label or why you chose that label. So it's great to hear from yourself, Mark, about the origins of it and why you decided on it. We're talking about them today in this episode in the context of them as consumers. And I've always been maybe a little bit conscious that sometimes it can come across a little bit, I don't know what the right word is, too advanced or too premature or a bit like not good intention, not with good intention, to kind of think as kids as consumers. However, the oldest of the alphas are already turning 13, and we're going to talk about today just how much influence they do have already as young kids on consumption households for their family. Their purchasing power is kind of starting to be felt, I think, a little bit more. So we're talking about them as consumers, and we put down in our presentations around this research when we launched this at a virtual event, and I know that you had a really cool slide kind of having some of the phrases and some of the defining characteristics about the alphas, and all of that was to say that they're going to be the most influential generation. So Mark, I wondered if you could, for our listeners of the podcast, just describe some of those phrases and those terms and some of the characteristics that we do assign to this generation.
Yeah. And just on that point about them being consumers, this is, people ought not get hung up on that. This is not about how to market to this generation, how to cut and slice them into a marketing cohort, but they're consumers in the sense that they consume education and they consume energy and they consume products and services. And we need to meet the best goals and outcomes for them by understanding what they're looking for and how they consume what they have in their life and world and future, to make sure we're fit for purpose in meeting their needs. But nor are they just consumers, they're contributors as well. And they add so much value, even though, like all humans, they're consuming lots of things, particularly at this life stage. So yes, we said that they're an important cohort of consumers to understand. Firstly, because of their demographic size, they're the largest generation in the history of the world. And you mentioned more than the 2.5 million born globally every week. I mean, phenomenal. More than 2 billion of these Gen Alphas on the planet. Peak births, peak children, peak young generation is what we have in the world. And that's this generation. And not only are they a massive demographic, they're the most globally connected, so they're a truly global generation. And they're the most materially endowed, because we've got the rise of the middle class right around the world. It's amazing how technology and education and just global trade has helped to lift a generation and an emerging world from subsistence existence. And so pretty phenomenal, this rise of the middle class. In fact, if we look at Generation Alpha and where there are the most of them, the number one country in the world is India, and number two is China. And these countries have seen massive rises in average net wealth and standard of living and indeed quality of life, education and earnings as well. So the rise of the middle class. Number three country in the world for alphas, if we wanted to know, is Nigeria. So Africa on the list as well. And again, these are three countries that not only dominate the world of youth, but they dominate the emerging middle class as well. So the most materially endowed generation in history, we're talking about the most technologically supplied generation ever. And that's pretty self-evident with this generation, who from the youngest age have these technology tools in their hands and really pretty much are innovative with it and learn how to use it. And because of that, if you look at this generation being the most formally educated and globally connected and materially endowed and technologically supplied and demographically significant, that also means that they will be the most influential generation that our world has ever seen, because you just combine those things, a big generation with education and tools and an economic footprint to match the demographic one, they will create change. If we don't understand and engage with Generation Alpha, we will clearly edge towards irrelevancy. And so that's an important wake-up call for educators and leaders and politicians and community experts and marketers and business leaders as well, to understand and engage with the alphas.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think particularly as the oldest of them reach 13 this year and we inch ever closer to all of that generation finished being born, I think someone could have been forgiven maybe like 5 years ago for not really having the alphas on their radar. They're like, oh, they're still got heaps of years left to be born. They're still one and two. And that's true. But at the younger end, there's only a year and a bit left of their births. And yes, the younger of them are really young, 1 or 2 years old or three, but the oldest of them are starting to have more and more influence. So there's really no excuse for why people and why brands and organizations shouldn't have them on their radar, and for all those reasons that you just mentioned there as well, Mark. But speaking of and thinking about what influences people and children at that life stage when they are so young, we wanted to investigate that in this research. And one way that we tried to do that was to investigate the themes of content that children today are engaging with. And of course, like we did with the whole report, we kind of segmented everything by generation. And we love to do that because it always yields really interesting differences across the generations and across the cohorts, as you know, Mark. So I wondered if you could talk through some of our research here around the research that we did conduct with parents and some of the areas that had the greatest difference, or some of the things that stood out to you, or the themes that stood out to you around what's different between, say, what the baby boomers or the Gen Xers said that they were learning about when they were kids versus what alpha children are learning about today.
Well, some of those factors that we just shared about them being globally connected, growing up with big births, seeing global flows of populations, means that cultural diversity and inclusivity is something that's far more on the radar of young people today, of this generation, than the baby boomers experienced at the same age. Environmental concerns are front of mind for this generation. As you know, in that research we ran, Ash, we found that 4 in 5 parents of Generation Alpha said they've had their consumption decisions and behaviours to be influenced to be more environmentally friendly by their Generation Alpha young children. So environmental considerations from a young age are on the radar of this generation, whereas the baby boomers and Gen Xers, when we surveyed them, said it wasn't something that we focused in on. Just the changing social mores and social values. We've run studies looking at things like global inequality, educational opportunities, things like resource scarcity and gaps in the haves and the have-nots, and racism, for example. All of these were issues that the youngest generation were far more heightened on and aware of, and at a young age, even more acute in terms of focused on these issues and seeing them as major issues to be aware of and respond to than the older generations, and all at a young age. So yeah, it's definitely a generation that are tuned into the social issues of the day, and often through social media that comes to their awareness, to therefore even before their parents might be aware of it, tuned into global issues, and at the point now as they move through these high school years where they're wanting to not just have an awareness of it but make a difference in this space. Keep in mind, in 5 years' time, the oldest Gen Alphas will be finishing school. They'll be either moving into further study or the workforce. By the time we close out the 2020s, just a few years after that, and move into the 2030s, this generation will be adults, or at least some of them, and more of them becoming adults every year. So big changes ahead. It'll fast hit us, and it's a generation already tuned into the issues of this day, the challenges of this world, and the responsibilities they have to bring about change.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd also be keen, Mark, to hear your thoughts on whether you feel like it's fair and valid for us to be able to draw parallels between the content that we consume and the messaging that we receive through the content, through the books, through the TV shows, through entertainment media that we receive in our childhood, like for the alphas you talked about, looking after the environment and cultural diversity and inclusivity. Do you feel like it's okay for us to draw parallels between some of those messages and then some of the values or the priorities that we hold as consumers as we get older?
Yes. You know, a lot of what shapes us is life stage. And so, you know, people might hear this discussion about these children, these Gen Alphas, and say, oh, yeah, well, but as they mature, they'll get more focused on other issues. Their priorities will change. They will have a different approach to life, a different worldview. And there's an extent to which that's the case. There's an extent to which children think differently, prioritize differently to teenagers, to adults, and to those in their senior years. Of course, we're a factor of life stage, and they'll mature and change. They're not going to stay as they currently are in terms of children. But so much of what drives us is actually shaped in our formative years. And we call them formative years for a reason. There's an old Jesuit saying, give me a child till he's seven and I'll show you the man, I'll show you the woman. In other words, we can get a sense as to what someone will be like in their adult years by observing them in their childhood years, because so much of the values is shaped. We talk about the nature versus nurture effect, and we recognize that much of who we are is genetic. It's nature. It's passed down from a hereditary perspective. Oh, you're a chip off the old block, this sort of thing. But much of it is through nurture, is through our environment, our upbringing. And that is not just the familial environment or the community environment. It's the environment of the times, the technologies, the events, the experiences, the social markers, we call them, that shape us, particularly in those formative years, which might extend into the teenage years, but certainly when we're young and malleable and working out our way in the world. And a lot of that, I'm sure, as adults, we can reflect, does stick with us. So yes, some of what we see today will change as they mature, but a lot won't. And these are different times that are shaping them to what previous generations have. Now, some of it will shape them, not because they will follow along with that, but they'll say, I was really indoctrinated in that area, or, you know, when I was growing up, you know, that was just the big thing and I reacted against that. So it'll still shape them in a contrarian way, because they saw so much saturation from a particular issue, or there was so much social engineering around an issue, or they reacted so much to an issue as well. So whether it conforms them into that worldview or pushes them from that worldview, nonetheless, the times that we're exposed to in our formative years do tend to shape us and our future as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to give one stat about this, it was interesting to see that when we asked that question about what topics do you remember learning about and the content you engaged with, baby boomers, 17% of the baby boomers said they remember learning about looking after the environment. And then when we asked that for the parents of Generation Alpha on behalf of their children, it was 42%. So 42 compared to 17. So we really see some big generational differences there around some of that content and using that environmental kind of awareness as an example. We really do see a difference across the generations. And I think it's helpful to hear how much of an impact it does have. Like we said, when they're in our formative years, it bears a different impact than when we hear these messages when we're a bit older or a bit more established. So
yeah, totally. I mean, in that study, we found as well, we put down the issues of sexual identity and gender fluidity, and we found hardly any traction with the baby boomers. They said when we were young, these were not issues discussed or on the agenda. And yet we asked the parents of Generation Alpha, they say, well, all the time, it's just something of this era, and it's something of their upbringing. So yeah, further examples of how the times shape us, and that while we might share life stages, and while we might share, here we are in Australia, you know, an Australian upbringing or a Western upbringing, the times change. And coming of age in the 1960s was different to us Gen Xers coming of age in the 1980s, different to Gen Alpha coming of age in the 2020s.
Yeah, and it's really interesting. When I remember when we were doing this research and this question, I kind of thought back to those circumstances where, like, you have a few generations at a family lunch or something, or someone of an older generation says something and then a younger person says, oh, that wouldn't fly today in my friendship group. And the same can sometimes be said even with content you consume, or you watch a show from a few decades ago and you watch it in today's context and you go, oh, that's interesting that they explored that issue, or they said it in this way, or, you know, it's the times shape us and the context changes. And you really do see that in something even like the content we consume, whether it's entertainment or messaging. So it was fascinating for us to kind of see that in the stats as well. And something else we explored, of course, because in this study we weren't surveying the alphas themselves, but we were surveying the parents of the alphas and getting the alpha insights through asking the parents. And we found that parents of this generation do face some unique challenges because of that unique context that we just talked about. Some of the tensions that we explored were, and some of the insights were, that 89% of parents of Generation Alpha say they feel the tension of wanting to help their children succeed while recognizing it is important to let them fail. 87% said they feel the tension of letting their children engage with screens, but also trying to not let it be too much. 85% of parents of Generation Alpha agree that their children are exposed to more mature content than they were at the same age. So exactly what we just talked about there, and different types of content. And 77% said they are uncomfortable with some of the content that is being created for children today. So some challenges and some tensions. But we also found that 73% said that they're hopeful about the world their children will inherit. So Mark, I wanted to just get your reflections on that. Did any of those statistics or the tensions or the challenges that parents of this generation today, did the sentiment surprise you? Did the proportion who I agree surprise you at all?
It totally was what we see in our social research, and it was and I think what parents just experience as well, this tension, because when it comes to parenting, we reflect on our own upbringing, and that becomes the model. Maybe a model that we follow, maybe a model that we say, I had that, therefore I'm going to do it differently. But nonetheless, that's the experience, that's the context that we know. And so the parents of today say, well, when I grew up, it was more of a play-based era, but now it's more of a screen-based era. And so, you know, how do we handle that tension? They say, well, we had more freedom growing up. You know, we would ride our bikes, we would hang out with kids in the street. But now it's an era where there's expected to be a bit more protection, and, you know, the helicopter parent model emerges. We grew up and failure was just part of life, but now, you know, every child gets the prize. The trophy at the end of the soccer game is distributed evenly week by week across the whole team. And so parents are in this point of tension. Well, I had a different upbringing, and I want to reflect back to that upbringing because it worked for me, but I recognize that it's a different era and that it's a different generation, and so maybe I ought to adapt a little. And that's the big challenge that parents face, that transition from what they experienced and knew to what their children are being shaped in, and how much do they be countercultural and say, well, actually, because of this era of perhaps overprotection, of indoors, of screen-based, I'm going to get my child out to do a bit more, to challenge them, to maybe get them doing some traditional activities. That's the big tension that parents face, and they navigate that journey as they go. And that's what we were picking up in that research.
Yeah, absolutely. It's definitely, and I imagine a lot of parents would say, you know, at parenting different generations at different times, every generation of parents have faced tensions. It's never been straightforward, but the context in which they're navigating is, of course, changing. And in previous generations had to maybe combat different technologies in different ways and different tensions. But we're, of course, talking about the current generation and the unique kind of context that these parents today are parenting Generation Alpha in. And even the fact that this oldest generation, as we've mentioned already on the podcast today, but the oldest of them are now becoming teenagers, is a pretty significant kind of life stage, entering the teen years. They technically, up until now, this generation haven't really been supposed to have been on social media. I think a lot of them, from what we've read and seen from the research for the book, a lot of them still know the trending dances and the audios and the influences. So they probably have been consuming maybe some of these trends, but it seems like now the oldest of them have started to be able to contribute, and they might have gotten social media accounts. And I just feel like I've seen anecdotally anyway, a lot of social media on TikTok, on Instagram, people start to talk a lot more about the alphas, and they're like, oh, even the Gen Zs are like, oh, the alphas are coming. Like, what are they going to be like? The oldest of them are starting to kind of appear on social media and have a bit of a voice. So would you say that that is a fair reason, perhaps, why many people are kind of starting to sit up and take notice, and we're even getting more requests to advise organizations on who this generation is because they're kind of, the oldest of them are now reaching those important teen years?
Yeah, definitely. They've hit that point of influence, of content creation, of those high school years, and where they're getting some jobs and spending some money and having more of that influence just as they age as well. And that's we find with parents that have got Generation Alpha children now, and they even compare that to the children that might be a few years older, and they really see that difference as well, because their older children, they say, well, they had smartphones, but there's a lot of texting going on. But now the extent to which they're absorbed on these apps, on the TikTok, on sharing messages back and forth on different platforms, is at a new level. The older kids use the internet to do research, but now the younger ones are using AI to help write essays or to do some research. It's just at a whole new level. The use of technology, the absorption in it, the platforms that they're using, the visual nature of the consumption, even with parents that look at children a few years older than their current alphas.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great to see that. I think more people are aware that Generation Alpha are here and are coming. And again, that's just been highlighted to us in the sheer amount of requests that we get to give comment and the notifications we get when we're kind of cited in things. And one thing that happened earlier this year, which was very cool, was that the Harvard Business Review came to us and asked us to, you know, they'd seen our phrases about this being a generation with a huge economic footprint and being aware of that. And they kind of wanted us to give some more hard facts to that. So I remember at the time I was talking to you about it, I received the media request, and then a great colleague of ours, one of our analysts, kind of sat in and helped. We created a bit of a methodology around kind of trying to pinpoint a dollar figure about the kind of economic influence that this generation is going to have. And it was really cool to see. And the paper that the Harvard Business Review put out was the business case for understanding Generation Alpha. And they had a lot of different insights that they gathered. And part of that was some economic modeling that we had gathered. And so our modeling suggests that by 2029, when the oldest generation alphas enter adulthood and the youngest generation alphas reach the age of 5, that the generation's economic footprint across the globe will reach more than 5.46 trillion. I think billion is hard to get your head around, but trillion, more than $5 trillion. And as I mentioned, we created this estimation based on some population projections across the world and how big this generation will be and the average expenditure. And so there's a lot of economic modeling that went into it. I know that you and our colleague Kevin kind of really delved into that. So I wondered, Mark, if you could just elaborate on that for our listeners.
Sure. And that's an annual spend of Generation Alpha, as we forecast to, as you said, when the oldest becomes adults. And so it's a pretty phenomenal figure. It's in US dollars, firstly. We were conservative with the modeling, and we looked at what the consumption of Generation Alpha is that they have influence over. So, you know, they're going to consume a proportion of utilities and energy costs in the household, but they're not making the decision in their households as to which water company or which electricity or you know, gas supplier, et cetera, is going with, or the use of the furniture. You know, we left that out of it. That's the adult decision. We just looked at the food that they would consume, sometimes a proportion of the holiday and recreation spend that they will consume. We looked at their own earnings and direct spend from that as well.
Generation Alpha have a huge influence, as you know, Mark, and we really have seen a lot of companies and organizations a lot more interested in understanding this generation. And one indicator of that to us was when the Harvard Business Review came to us and asked us to do some economic modeling around the kind of economic power or influence this generation is going to yield. And our colleague Kevin kind of sat down with you and you guys really nutted that out and did some really robust insights for that article. And what it found was that by 2029, so when the oldest generation alphas enter into adulthood and the youngest generation alphas reach the age of 5, their economic footprint will reach more than 5.46 trillion US dollars, which is just a phenomenal number to get your head around. And we created this estimation based on some population projections and economic modeling. Mark, I wonder if you could just elaborate on our listeners how we kind of came to that figure and what that means.
Yes, it's a big number. And that's the annual spend of Generation Alpha, and also what not only they spend, but what is spent on them that they influence. So we took a pretty conservative approach with this economic model. We just looked at what they directly influence and spend. So we looked at things like the food that they consume and the clothes that they buy and wear. We looked at the entertainment and recreation spend of their life, and indeed the education spend as well. We didn't include things like their share of energy consumption in a household or the furniture that is being used, because that's being made by the householder, by the parents, not so much them. And so we just took both what they earn and spend directly and what they directly influence that is spent on them. And that is the annual figure, $5.46 trillion US dollars. Pretty big number. And it grows year by year, obviously, until they all hit adulthood. Indeed, it continues to grow until they reach the peak point of economic spend, which is in their 30s and into their 40s. So this is a generation that already is spending serious money, that will grow to spend even more. It's the largest amount that any young generation has ever had. Firstly, because as we said, their size is larger. The middle class of this generation is greater, but also the amount that they influence at a younger age is more than previous generations have. And that's why we have the nearly $5.5 trillion annual spend of alpha coming our way globally very soon.
Yeah, it's an incredible projection to have and to have created. So well done to you and Kevin for all the complexities that went into that. As we look to the future, Mark, is there anything else that you feel that we need to know, our audience needs to know, or marketers need to know about Generation Alpha as consumers?
Well, that they are consuming not as individuals. We don't want to just understand them as individuals, but as a cohort, as a generation. So what influences them in their social context will influence them as consumers individually. Keep in mind their family context, their life stage context. And so often to understand the Gen Alpha consumer, we need to understand the parents of the Gen Alpha and what their values and expectations are. We're seeing when it comes to educational choices and money invested in their children, the parents are more focused on the future. They recognize that they need to invest money in this. They are thinking about the future of their children. They're more aware of nutrition and health choices and protection for their children, whether that be sun care or just medical care. And so the parents are making influences with their children and their future in mind. The children influencing those decisions, and the children are influenced by their own peer group through social media and their own connections. So all of that creates a complexity as to what shapes the choices of Gen Alpha, but certainly, you know, that's going to shape the future. The other thing is that it's a dynamic generation adapting to change very quickly. Change is all they've ever known, and so they're on the cutting edge of it, you know, of all of the generations. And so the technologies we see today won't be the technologies of their adulthood. Some of it will change, some of it will remain, but a lot of it will adjust and adapt. So as we think about Alpha in the future, and that's a good way to do it, you know, Generation Alpha is not just the generation now, it's a good way to prepare for the future. It's a good way to give tangibility to think about the 2030s or the 2040s. It's going to be a Gen Alpha world. So by understanding them now, we can prepare. Keep in mind that much of what we have today won't be normative then. Things will change. The pendulum will swing back and forth, and there'll be new innovations as well. But if we can understand the Alphas, who are adaptive to change and on the cutting edge of technology adoption, I think we'll be better placed to get an understanding of the future as we look through the lens of the children of today.
It's such a great reminder, Mark. And it reminds me as well of the slide that we use in our presentations where we kind of talk about the outgoing technologies and things that we're using today that the Alphas will probably never use, like a fax machine or a landline phone or a traditional GPS system or a wallet. Like I think some of those first things I mentioned, we go, yeah, yeah. But then you think, will they have credit cards? Probably not. Will they have wallets? They won't need them. They may not even wear analog watches. And it's kind of getting into that tangible of like, what's the world going to be like in the future and through the lens of this generation. So yeah, fantastic insights as always. Amazing to chat to you as always as well, Mark. So thanks so much for your time on the podcast today.
Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to McCrindle.com or GenerationAlpha.com for that matter. So as always, thank you again for listening and bye for now.